Hello, welcome back to Podcast Versus Player, episode 96. I'm Carl, and as always, I'm joined by a man who finally got the Indiana Jones sequel he wanted. It's called Uncharted 4. No fridges, no monkeys, no fucking Shia LaBeouf, or whatever the hell he's meant to be. And just a man with his stubble, the way it ought to be when you're home alone playing a video game. It's only bloody Dan.
I'm surprised they haven't done an Uncharted-inspired Indiana Jones game. Oh, wait, no, that would just be Uncharted, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
No, I think if you just did, maybe that's it. They're going to stop doing Nathan Drake, and the next one's going to be like Jim Deanna Bones or something.
Jim Deanna Bones.
Yeah, it's just like, no, it's not. It's not from the film, so we don't have to pay George Lucas anything. No,
it's a spin-off of Uncharted.
Yeah.
It's just a character we name dropped in the first one that nobody seemed to.
Yeah, notice. It was an Easter egg. Like,
don't look back at it. That'd be amazing.
It would be pretty good.
Before we ramble on, Dan, let's get this thing out of the way. This week's podcast is bought by our affiliate Spotlight Deals, where this week you can pick up Doom for £34.78 on PlayStation 4 and Xbox One, or £34.07 on PC. If you would like to pick up any of those versions, or all of them, whatever, you can head over to podcastversusplayer.com/... Spotlight. I didn't say splash.
No, you didn't this time. Well done.
No,
you're not totally
every single week. And this week's affiliate spotlight deal is bought by GameSeek, UK and Europe's number one online video game retailer.
Boom, done it. Sorry, I was yawning then.
Dan's really, really into this.
Yeah, I'm so up for this. Let's do it.
He's only played like 23 hours straight of GTA.
Man, honestly, you have no idea.
I do have an idea. We went to this podcast yesterday.
I know, right? I can't help it.
Dan's like, I can't do a podcast today. I was like, that's fine, I'll do it tomorrow. And he's like, play like GTA for like 11 hours. It's like,
yeah.
You're playing GTA now, that's why we haven't done a podcast.
It's yeah.
Like, yeah, I was in the middle of a heist.
It was a really good heist as well. But that was 11 hours straight, that was yesterday. I honestly,
that's a long heist.
I'd totally forgotten how just addictive it is. It's so big, and I mean, obviously this is the PC version, so it's been revamped slightly. But the reason why I didn't get it when it came out for the PC was simply for the fact that I didn't want to spend £40 on a game that I'd already spent £40 on and got it on release, you know, and I'd spent 3 or 4 days just poring over it when it came out. But then I didn't really go back and do the story again. But then, what was I watching? I think I was watching Funhouse, and they were doing some GTA stuff, and I was just like, I need to get GTA for the PC. Like, the online stuff is actually, it's not dying on its arse.
Yeah.
Like, it's still relevant, and people still enjoy it, and it's, they're still pumping stuff into it. And, you know, I can only be impressed by that. So I thought, well, it's got to be, you know, it's been out for, what, at least a year for the remastered one.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it has to be, because I got it last year.
Mm. Well, that was what I was thinking, because I know that I played it at yours on PS4, so we could check out the first person mode and stuff. So I thought, it's got to be, you know, sort of £30 at most now, because it's been out for so long. Plus, that's a remaster of a game that's already 2 years old.
Yeah.
Still £40 everywhere.
Yeah.
So I was like, ah, fuck it. And I got
on G2A today, it's £28.
No! I'd get a refund.
It's not really.
Not even joking. There was like a... like a Rockstar Social Club only code, but because I wasn't entirely sure as to what that meant, I didn't trust it. So I still got it through Steam, so I still got it for £40.
Did you get your character back?
Did you ever
play the ad line?
Yeah. I did. Like, because
I transferred mine.
I got $2 billion when I was playing online initially, but I haven't got that $2 billion anymore. I've got like $84,000, but I've got an amazing apartment, like the best apartment, and then like 6 cars that have all been like really, really fucking done up, and then I've got like 2 guns. Because whilst I was playing it, just someone decided to gift me $1 billion, and then obviously people have been hacking or whatever, so I'm glad to see that whatever damage these people have done to the online has been reversed. But I still got $83,000 out of it, and kept all my cars and my apartment and stuff, so I can plan heists and stuff for my super swanky apartment. And all my cars are like just tricked out, but I've got no guns, no bullets, and I'm level 14, I think.
Higher than me. I haven't really played the online a lot, to be honest.
Well, that was the thing. Like, I wanted to get into it, but with people, because that's the only way you can really sort of do like the missions and the heists and stuff like that. I mean, the heists were the big one. That's what everyone was waiting for. But it wasn't until the PC and the remastered version came out that they actually launched heists.
It wasn't actually that long ago. Like,
no, it was only, I'd say,
Heist wasn't on it when I got the remastered.
No, it was after the remasters and everything had come out. But I've just been going through the story mode again, and it's just so engaging, and it's so well acted, and it just looks amazing, and it's just so good.
Yeah.
But I'm glad that I've left it this long before I've gone back and played it, because everything's fresh again. I forgot.
Yeah, you forget. I mean, to be fair, I mean, I got the remaster last year, and I started playing it, and I forgot a lot of the stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
From, like, the original, like, PS3, Xbox 360 version.
Yep.
Have you tracked down any of the peyote plants?
No.
That's pretty fun, like, you turn into an animal.
Yeah.
Me and Zoe spent quite a long time looking for them.
Yeah.
But, I mean, there's quite a few missions at the beginning that it launched, and I was like, oh, I remember this one, I don't like this mission.
Well, I tell you, the only thing I really don't like, I mean, they fixed most of the issues they had with it. The main one being that shooting from cars was an absolute nightmare.
Yeah.
But now it's like two separate buttons, like one to aim, one to shoot. That's fine. That's all they needed to do. Clearly they took the feedback on board. Well done for fixing it. The whole bronze, silver, gold mission things, and it still doesn't tell you what you need to do in order to get there in the first place before you do it, is a pain in the ass. But secondly, the fact that they think they need to do it is another issue. Like, I had a mission today that was preparing for a heist, right? And there was two objectives. Again, something that you don't find out until you've completed whatever sort of submission or mission that you're doing.
Mm.
And one of them was to buy new boiler suits. You've got to buy boiler suits for a heist, right? And then the objective was buy three boiler suits. And then the second objective was do it under a minute. So I got a silver medal.
It's just like, seriously,
like, yeah, for one, you didn't tell me that I had a time limit on it, and two, why have you put a time limit on it? I have to go into one shop and buy three things. Why do I need to do that? Why can't I have a look at the colours and stuff? It's just this whole rating system in games these days.
Oh yeah, that'd be the other thing, is the gold
winds me up.
Is buy the boiler suits, do it under a minute, and they're all blue, you get gold. But if you've got green ones, it'd be a silver.
Yeah, but then it's just like, if I want to go for 100% completion through the story mode, right, that means that at some point I'm going to have to go back into that one mission and just buy those boiler suits again, and then do it, then leave and do something else. What a waste of my fucking time.
It's a bit stupid.
It is, and I really don't like the fact that they've done this. I'm hoping it's just them sort of appeasing the masses, if they're used to sort of being graded. Oh, you know, you only did three backflips in this, A. And you're like, oh, damn it, I wanted triple S. Fuck off with your fucking rating systems. Just enjoy it.
Speaking of things you don't like, Dan, I've got some bad news.
Disney Infinity's back. No!
I wish. No Man's Sky has been delayed.
Yeah, August, I think, isn't it?
Yeah,
I did see this earlier.
The site has been pushed back from the 21st of June to the 9th of August. So not massively that long, really.
Nah, not really.
And delays usually mean making the game better, hopefully, anyway. Hmm. However, Dan, this news has made people very angry.
Joking.
No Man's Sky developer Sean Murray has revealed he has received death threats following the minor delay to Hello Games' hotly anticipated space simulator. Obviously, we just said it's going to be delayed from 21st of June to the 9th of August, so we've got just over a month to wait. Oh no. The studio believes the extra time will result in a better product. To his credit, Murray tweeted about how the Guildford-based outfit's HQ has been transformed into the house from Home Alone, complete with pillow fortresses and other makeshift traps, he tweets. Tell me when it's safe to remove the marbles and oil from the stairs. It's getting really cumbersome and I need the toilet. However, this all began after Kotaku writer Jason Schreier broke the news about the delay. And whereas most of the internet reacted in a calm manner, others decided to accuse Kotaku of lying and apparently made death threats. Death threats over a video game being delayed. Jason Schreier broke the news and received the following death threat. And this is comedy gold, Dan.
Go on.
Your little article about No Man's Sky being delayed has made me hate you to my very core. It's the only thing I live for, and you go and write that bullshit about a delay. Instead of visiting London later this month, I think I'll come by and say hi to you and fuck you up. You think you can get away with this that easy? Making fun of our Reddit page also? Sounds like you have a death wish. We will find you. Be afraid, human. We are coming for you.
Who do people think they are?
This guy, right, who has then created an entire Reddit page about Jason Schreier from Kotaku, about how he's caused the delay and this, that, and the other. He's a news journalist. He's found out No Man's Sky is going to be delayed.
Let everyone know.
Yeah, which was then confirmed by the developers, and then this guy gets death threats.
Christ almighty.
It is absolutely insane. And I was reading through the Reddit page, and there's some really bad stuff on there. And then late, there was also on the side of the Reddit thingy, like a most commented thing. Yeah. Totally off subject, some girl slept with her boyfriend's dad, and the guy saw some pictures on a phone, on his dad's phone, sorry. And some, he's taken photos of the conversation, and as you would, he's gone to Reddit and said, I need some advice, what do I do? And literally, say there's 50 comments, at least 40 something percent of them, choker, killer. It's like, that's not really advice. But that's essentially what these people from this Reddit about Jason Schreier are saying, we need to kill him and stuff. And it's like, he's a journalist, he's doing his job.
Yeah. I mean, if you receive some news to say, oh, you're I'm just calling from a car dealership, your car's actually not going to be delivered on time, would you then go, well, I'm going to have to come around and kill you then?
Yeah. That's some,
I mean, that would be my ideal world, because I think a lot of problems would get sorted almost immediately. Because if you called up Amazon, say, oh, I bought this thing from you, it's supposed to be delivered today but I haven't received it, oh, the courier's not actually going to be able to turn up today, they're going to come there tomorrow, okay, brilliant, I want the courier's name and address, I want your name and address, and then I'm going to have to come around and kill you both. I do have a shotgun and I'll blow your heads off. And you go, actually, give me 20 minutes, I'm seeing if I can figure something out for you. Brilliant, thanks very much, I'll speak to you in a bit. Then boom, it turns up.
Oh, they'll call the police. They already have your address.
No, because this is my world. And in my world, make a death threat, it's substantiated and people act on it. In a sort of purge way. Because then you go, right, on the 28th of June, purge day, you better bloody lock your doors and sit in the basement or something, because I'm fucking coming for you, sunshine.
So in your ideal world, nothing gets delivered on time.
No. It's not instant. They've still got, if they say it's going to be 5 days, I expect it to be within those 5 days. If it takes 6 days, you're dead. No problems.
Oh my lord.
And I only say that because I had an issue with Amazon fairly recently.
And you killed them.
Yeah, I killed them all, that's right. No, I've got Amazon Prime, I think something I'd mentioned before.
Yeah.
A mate of mine said, the Dishonored remaster's going to be coming out, or it's out for PS4 or something like that, sorry. Would you mind getting it on Amazon Prime for me so I can play it over the bank holiday weekend, the weekend that we've literally just had? So I was like, yeah, no problem. And it was like a tenner or something, so it's not like it's a new barbecue or something. So, went on, there's Xbox One, Prime eligible, PS4, Prime eligible, PS4, buy. Next day, your thing's going to be delivered on Tuesday, as in tomorrow. And this was on the Wednesday, because I had the Friday off. No, I had the Thursday and the Friday off.
Yeah.
And I had to go over and say, this thing that was Prime yesterday and was Prime when I clicked on it is now going to take like 7 or 8 days or something to get here. and he wasn't happy about it because he wanted to spend that weekend, because his missus wasn't there, playing Dishonored and stabbing motherfuckers. So I had to send him an email just saying, right, I bought this yesterday and it was Prime eligible and I checked and now you're telling me it's going to take a week, what the fuck? And they said, oh, sorry, you know, sometimes there's an overlap between the systems being updated and blah, blah, blah. And that was it. They just said, yeah.
Well, no, fuck off, it was advertised.
Exactly my point. That's why they should die. Whoever it was who sent me that email, I should be able to go around there legally and throw him to the floor and choke him to death. And then pick up a copy of Dishonored on the way out.
Because he just happens to have your order sat there and like, I'm not sending it till next week.
Yeah, basically, that's how I assume it happens. You know, they've got a pigeonhole thing, and then they have, it's like the Argos stockroom. So they nip down to the warehouse, grab it, pop it in an envelope, stick it in the postbox, or take it to the post office, and then they do that for everything. And this guy was just so fucking lazy that he couldn't be asked to get off his fucking ass, go downstairs, pick up a copy of Dishonored, and stick it in the post for me. What's wrong with him? Die. I think that's how Amazon works. I'm not too sure.
This week's podcast brought to you by Amazon. Next day delivery on every item.
No, it does bug me when stuff like that happens. I mean, usually because if Amazon fuck me over, they say, oh, we're really sorry about that. Here's an extra month of Amazon Prime for free. And that usually calms me down a bit. They didn't do it this time. So I think that they've got like a note on the system saying, we've given this guy like 6 months of free Amazon Prime membership. Bear in mind that they offered it. I didn't say...
Yeah, but this is the reason you've had extended
Prime
membership. Yeah, because they fucked up. If they didn't fuck up, you would never extended for
Absolutely.
Free.
Absolutely. You're paying £80 a year, for Christ's sake. I expect this, yeah. You know, and they always put a massive paragraph in there saying, we know that you're paying for Amazon Prime and we know that it's a premium service and we're really sorry that this has happened. So all I was expecting them to do is just give me another month and they didn't even give me that this time. It's a slap in the dick.
All they had to do was slap it in the fucking postbox and go, it was advertised as Prime.
No, they literally just ran out of stock. So I was just like, oh, you cunts.
But yeah, but if that had been a shop though, and you went up, you're like, I've Dishonored, please, and it's got £10 on the box, and you slap it in there, go, that's £15.99, please. Like, it says £10 on the fucking box. I'm like, oh yeah, yeah, sorry, we forgot to change the price. Well, yeah, I forgot to give you £6 extra. There's £10.
Well, that's what it says on the box. Now, that one can't get away with.
That's what it's advertised
as. If they charged me for 15 quid or something, then I would have had every right to go back to them and say, no, that's what it said on the fucking website. I'm going to have to take a screenshot of everything I order before I click go, just to make sure that they say, look, this is what I signed up for, this is what I'm paying for, and you're not doing it. You're breaking the contract that we've got, so what the fuck?
And when you are, you're taking fucking weeks.
Yeah. So I don't even know why we were talking about Amazon then. What was I can't remember. I got really annoyed about them.
We was on about No Man's Sky.
Oh yeah.
I don't even know how we got onto that.
No, it's because they annoyed me. But the thing is though, it's not their fault, and it's just like it's the journalist guy. It's not his fault, it's the developers. If they say, look, we can release it now, but you'll complain more if we release a shit or broken game. Then you just say, yeah, you take your extra month. If they pushed it back 3 years, fair enough. You go, well, that's a bit out. You know, we were all waiting for that.
People, it's not death threat worthy.
No, of course it's not. Absolutely not. If they said, well, we're cancelling the project and we're not going to refund any pre-orders, then go, okay, well, I spent 45 quid on this. I'm very annoyed. I'm going to, you know, pester you with emails until you give me your back. But if someone tells you that they've cancelled the pre-order, you don't death threat that guy. It's like, I didn't do anything. I don't even work for the fucking company. What do you want me to do?
just doing my job.
It's the curse of the internet, though, isn't it? You know, people think that they can make whatever kind of threats without repercussions. And I hope that anyone who makes these kind of threats have their comeuppance and they are reported to the police to say, you know, as far as we're concerned, this could just be some guy venting and he's not being very polite about it. But we could consider this as an act, as a threat against my life. Therefore, I want him taken into custody.
Yeah, because I'm not being funny. I mean, anyone can find anyone these days. But somebody like Jason Schreier, he's going to have information on the internet about him because he's technically in the limelight because he works for a big publication.
Yeah, you'll have social media networking, all that kind of stuff. The contact details, it wouldn't take long to put two and two together.
No. And stuff like that, it's not to be taken lightly. And they've got, I mean, he tweeted a picture of the message he received on Twitter, like a private message. That's how I read the threat. And he tweeted it out. He still hasn't been banned from Twitter, or at least had a ban put on his, like a permanent, temporary ban on his account.
Yeah.
Like some people have when they've made threats and stuff. His account's still going. A load of people have been tweeting him, like calling him a dickhead and stuff. I totally forgot what I was going with that now. But it's not an excuse by any means, but the only people I can, who I see who should be allowed to be upset, not death threat worthy upset, but upset over games and stuff for kids. So all the kids that love Disney Infinity, they're going to be gutted now it's finished.
Yeah.
And stuff like that's fine. Let the kids be upset because it's something they enjoyed. A fully grown fucking man, that's ridiculous. And yeah. he should be arrested, not for sent to prison for 25 years or so, but just teach him a lesson.
Yeah, you can't. I think you're right in the fact that you can't take these things lightly. Because, you know, I'm sure that people who are, like you say, in the limelight, they must get these things all the time.
Yeah.
And I hope that they, you know, they really don't take it personally, because most of the time it will just be idiots on the internet. But the fact is, if you receive 50 death threats for writing an article, doing your job, you know, being a journalist, reporting on something that's happened, you know, that will affect people, because, that, you know, like I say, there'll be a lot of people who pre-ordered it, a lot of people excited for it, I'm excited for it. But if they say, we're going to take a month extra just to make sure it's okay, why would I begrudge them that? I haven't paid anything for it yet, so fucking just shut up and get on with it.
Even if you pre-ordered it, you're still going to get it.
Yeah, of course you are. I mean, they'll probably throw in a bit of DLC or something, or, you know, extra skins or whatever.
Yeah, thanks for your patience and stuff and whatnot, but at the end of the day, they don't have to.
No, absolutely not.
And it's every release date, it's just a placeholder.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Like, if you've made a Kickstarter or something like that, and your project is delayed and then delayed and then delayed and then delayed, and you say, look, I paid you, I'm a part of this project, then I can understand why you'd be slightly more upset. But the fact is that you've got nothing to lose. They could cancel this game right now. Would it affect you? No, it's just that you wouldn't get it.
Yeah.
Get over yourself.
Look at PT. I was incredibly looking forward to Silent Hills.
Yeah.
And then got cancelled. I was gutted, but oh well. It's not the end of the world.
No, absolutely.
It's a game at the end of the day. I mean,
yeah, of course.
We should be pushing. Games are amazing, blah, blah, blah. But at the end of the day, games aren't everything. Well, there's a lot more important things in the world.
Yeah, like killing everyone. Whenever they wrong you.
Making sure your Amazon Prime's.
I might kickstart my own sort of draconian empire or something like that. Like, look, I'll have to be in charge, but, you know, it'll be the best place. Everything will, the trains will run on time. You know, stuff will get delivered. The shops will always be open. You'll definitely get a job. Everyone will be safe, because if anyone falls out of line, they get killed.
They get killed.
It would be great. There'd only be 12 people that would end up living there.
Welcome to Germany.
Well, that's racist. That's incredibly racist. Well done.
In the war.
Right, yeah, well done. Because all Germans were all racist. You fucking idiot.
The Austrian ones was.
No, just the Nazis, actually. But they're still stupid people.
Yeah. But yeah, the point is, people.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Some people are idiots, some people aren't.
I think that if you know, are willing to take to the internet over something arbitrary like this and say, because of you, I'm going to threaten your life, because of, whether you mean it or not is kind of irrelevant. But the fact that you've taken the time to type something out and send it usually means that there's intent. And I think that they should be, their door should be kicked in, and they should be dragged off, and they should be given a fucking hiding. And they say, look, you're not going to go to prison. We're not going to waste taxpayers' money on court or anything like that. But the fact is, if you do anything like this again, we will. And we'll put you in prison 60 days, whatever. Because people shouldn't be allowed to get away with that. It's the equivalent of shouting abuse or threatening someone in public.
Yeah. What if he didn't write that, and he did go to wherever the guy's from, and he saw him in Starbucks or whatever, and he did the threat then. Didn't hurt him or anything, but he gave the threat.
Yeah.
He'd call the police.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I don't see why it's any different doing it written.
Because there's anonymity attached to it. People don't, you know, people wouldn't go up to someone in the street and say the things that they would on the internet.
No,
you know,
they're
too scared to. But I just don't think it's fair that anyone should be able to get this kind of abuse. But especially when it's something outside of your control as well. That's what I don't get.
Yeah, but it'd be the same situation if No Man's Sky is delayed and he didn't print the article and then they found out and then he's like, why the fuck didn't you tell us?
Yeah. I mean, did you hear anything about the people who were making Quantum Break? Did they all get death threats when they pushed it back and again and again and again and again?
I don't think so.
Uncharted. No, of course they didn't.
That was delayed a shitload, Uncharted. That was meant to be out, like, early last year.
Yeah, but it's. I just don't get it. Like, if Rockstar made GTA 6 and then 6 months before it was due to come out, they cancelled it. Or if there was Metal Gear 6 that was made by Kojima, for whatever reason he's back on board, and then with 6 months to go, it was cancelled. People would be gutted. I would be. I personally would be devastated, especially if I was expecting it to come out. But would I be so enraged and incensed that I'd have to take to the internet to Reddit and go, I'm absolutely outraged by this? It's like, well, no one fucking cares.
We'd say it on the podcast and we're like,
such and such have been cancelled.
Yeah.
Disney Infinity's fallen through.
Yeah.
Gutted about it, but there you go.
Oh, that's, well.
You know, it's a business decision, but ultimately it's a decision. All of these are decisions outside of the consumer's hands. Like I say, unless you've been involved in some sort of crowdfunding or Kickstarter program, then you've genuinely invested into it and you've lost it.
Even
but
then, though,
you know the risk of getting involved with it.
Yeah, it's stuff like Kickstarter, unless it's with an established brand, like the stuff that Tim Schafer's done on Kickstarter.
Yeah.
Unless it's with somebody like that, and it's something you know full well is going to go through, and you're going to earn a little bit of revenue back from it, or whatever the contract is. It's a risk. And I can go on Kickstarter and be like, here's my idea, I need 25 grand. And then I get the money, and then it doesn't fall through. I'm not in any way inclined to give them their money back.
No.
I know a lot of them have. A lot of people have got their money back from Kickstarters that have fallen through. But there's a much higher percentage of people that have got fuck all back. But that's your problem.
Yeah, absolutely. It's an investment.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that.
You're not investing. If there's a company making a game and they say, we need this amount of money, like Shenmue, Sega said, if we hit this goal, we'll make Shenmue 3. And obviously Sony's footed the rest of the fucking bill.
Yeah.
And within like X amount of time, bam, money's done. You may be an investor in Shenmue 3, but you are in no way anywhere near the level of the big corporation investors like Sony and Sega. And
yeah, they put millions
in there.
Just because you've
put 10 quid to it.
Yeah, exactly. You throw 20 quid into the pot and then go, well, I'm part owner in the business. And go, well, no, you've helped to contribute a little bit, but the fact is you're not going to be helping us make it. You've just simply proven that you and millions of other people want this to happen, and therefore the people with the real money come along and go, okay, we'll foot the bill. We'll take a punt on it, and but we want 48% of the return.
Yeah.
You people don't. Yeah. You just get a free copy of the game that you would have bought anyway.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. Like, a lot of the games, like Psychonauts 2 and Shenmue 3 and whatnot, the minimum backing to invest into the game is the price of the game.
Yeah, exactly.
So you don't gain anything out of it. You've only done what you were going to do if it was released anyway. So you haven't in any way helped the process of the game being made. Well, you've helped it be made, sorry, but you haven't made it.
Yeah, that's what I mean. There's very... It's a difficult thing. And it's obviously... Although I agree with sort of Kickstarters and stuff in principle, because I think that there are some products where you just go, I can't get a bank, I can't get a serious investor to get involved, but I know that this will be good, and if people want to help me, then they can get something back out of it as well. Now, that I don't mind. It's when people are, you know, saying, I want to buy a car, but I can't afford to, so I want everyone else to buy a car for me, basically.
That's then not that girl, it's just sort of like... Sorry, I was going to say it was a similar thing with a girl, and she couldn't afford to pay her rent, so she went to like GoFundMe or something like that.
Well, there was a woman who she'd spent her entire life savings with the American lottery. It was up to like $1 billion or something stupid. She'd spent her entire life savings on lottery tickets, won fuck all, and then started a Kickstarter campaign to reclaim her life savings from everyone else, and then do it again. that was what she said on the Kickstarter page, is that she would attempt again to get the. And it's just like, how fucking stupid are you? But people pay, you know, they give money to these people. It's just like, Jesus Christ, keep a hold of it.
That's ridiculous.
Unless it's something that you can physically benefit from, what's the point?
Yeah.
I mean, things for charities and stuff, that's totally different. If you want to do that, you're doing that out of the goodness of your heart, and you know that you're not going to get a return.
Yeah, but again, it's the same principle. In such and such charity, you've donated £400 over the course of a few years, and then the charity publicises, we're not getting enough funding, both from the public and the government, so we're going to have to shut shop. You're not then going to turn around and go, I want my money back.
Yeah, that was supposed to help people, but if you're not helping people, then what am I paying for?
Yeah, that's never going to happen.
No, but you're not expected to get a return on it. It's just sort of something to make yourself feel better.
Yeah.
Because as far as you know, that, like you say, a couple of years you may have been paying £2 a month, something like that, £400 overall that you've ended up spending, that may have just gone on stationery.
Yeah, to print how much help they need.
Yeah, you've got no idea as to what it actually goes to. So, I mean, personally, I'd say if you want to get involved with the charity, if you want to actually do something, I'd say get involved with them directly. So, you know, help feed the homeless, or, you know, go and build a school or a hospital, something like that. You know, do a marathon and take the money to the air ambulance, or, you know, help out at a sort of group therapy session, something like that. And that, you know, I'm sure that you'd feel infinitely better about that than pretending that you're high and mighty because you've got £20 a month going out in different direct debits. Bollocks, I don't buy it.
No.
You know, there are people who genuinely really want to help people, and they go out and do it. They go to hospitals and help and play with sick kids and stuff.
Yeah.
That's not my cup of tea. I'm not a very nice person. But the fact is, if you want to, that's the way... if I wanted to, that's the way around I'd do it. I'd want to go and make sure that... Yeah, actually sit down with someone and say, what's up? You know, be a Samaritan volunteer or something.
What's up?
You know, I mean, like, you know, over the phone or something. You know,
why are you so sad?
Yeah, you look a bit down, mate. What's up? Oh, I'm going to jump off a bridge. Ah, don't. You'll only pester everyone.
Just pat him on the back and push.
No, but that's the sort of thing I'd do. You know, I'd want to do something active and, you know, actually be involved and say, yeah, I went there and I know that I helped them because I was there and I helped build.
Because I physically helped them.
Yeah, sustainable housing, whatever it may be. You know, so if you want to do it, that's the way around I'd go. But certainly don't act like you're fucking better than everyone else just because you pay a few direct debits. Right,
yeah.
It's not the same.
It's stupid.
Where the fuck
anyway,
did that come from?
I have no idea. We've got very political. So
yeah, a little
I've got
bit.
I got a funny-ish story. Some guy's PlayStation 4 was playing up, so he took it to be repaired. This was in Brazil,
right?
And turned it on, and it turned off again, and then it smelt really bad. He turned it on, and it turned itself off again. It smelt really bad, so they opened it up. Dead snake.
Oh, jeez.
There was a snake inside the PS4.
How the fuck did it get in there?
Fuck knows. And it was... it had soldered itself to the... Every time it had been turned on, it was just... The circuit was just frying the snake.
Oh, Christ.
Nobody knows how the snake got in there. What we do know is this does not mean Metal Gear 6 is confirmed.
Metal Gear 6, Toasty Snake.
Toasty Snake. But yeah, that's quite weird.
That is really weird. I'm, maybe it's a manufacturing thing. Something in the warehouse managed to get in there, because that cover does not seem like it's something that's, you know,
would
be easy to get into.
No, you couldn't get into it. And
that's
the snake
what I mean.
Is. Yeah, there's actually some picture on. You can actually see the video of him opening the PlayStation up. But it's still like. Some of it's quite flat where it's burnt, basically, but it's still a reasonable sized, like, garter snake or something like that.
Right.
But there's literally no way it could crawl in there. The only thing I could think of is Kojima did it to a load before he went.
Maybe it's like a Willy Wonka thing.
You open it. Speak totally off subject, Dan. Right? You just really reminded me there. On a Saturday, I swung by the shop. I think Zoe wanted some Maltese or something like that. And
what shop? Supermarket?
Yeah, it was just like a spa or something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was in there, and then I had a little packet of like mini donuts. I was like, I'll get them for a little then. I was in the queue, and came to me, and I was paying for it. And the guy's like, oh, you got one of the new Beatrix Potter Peter Rabbit, 50p's. I was like, have I? And I had a look. I was like, oh yeah. Like, you know, give it him because it's a 50p. Found out today, you can't buy them anymore off like the Royal Mail or whoever makes fucking money. You can buy like the commemorative coins off the website, yeah. And they've sold out. I could have got 20 quid for that.
Oh shit, no way.
They're selling for 20 quid and some of them even more so. And if you've got a coloured one, it's like a really, really limited edition coloured Peter Rabbit coin. It's like 500 quid.
Fuck me.
I was like, oh man.
And that's just gutted. So they're like introduced into general circulation?
Yeah, there's only like 300 of them.
Wow.
And I was like, motherfucker.
Just go back and just give him 50 quid and just buy some chewing gum and just say, I'll have the rest in 50p's, it's fine. Yeah. All the change you've got, please. I bet he pocketed that, switched it out for one of his own. It's like, I'm having that.
I bet he did, because he knew about it. Because he's like, oh, the bitch looks Potter, like Peter Rabbit coin. I didn't even know, I saw his 50p in my pocket. It's like, god damn it.
Bloody hell.
That was me Willy Wonka moment.
Yeah, do you win a free rabbit or something?
I hope so.
Fine.
I sell 50p for 20 quid and get a free rabbit. Ace.
Yeah.
Good day out in Spire, that is. Anyway, that's it for the news, Dan. Right. However, main story.
You've got to get a wriggle on with it then.
I know, yeah. I haven't got a lot. It's not really that big, really. Okay. However, rumour has it there is two new Xbox consoles to be revealed at E3. Yeah. The first one is going to be a slimline Xbox One that will have 4K capabilities, which I'm guessing will just be for movies. And that'll just be a redesigned, slimmer Xbox One. Nobody cares about that. The second one...
I'm sorry, just to interrupt you there. I love the fact that they're going to make it 4K compatible, a gaming console, but it's very unlikely that any Xbox One games would be 4K compatible anyway.
Well, that's where the new news comes in.
They're doing another one that is another better hardware.
Yeah.
Codenamed
Scorpio, best star sign. This console, which is set to be released late 2017. Although it will probably be announced next month. Basically, the new PlayStation 4 codenamed Neo, which is basically for the PlayStation VR, obviously the VR needs to be powered. So you can buy the VR headset and it comes with like a box, you plug that into the PlayStation and it makes your PlayStation a bit more powerful and it powers the VR. Or you could buy the PlayStation 4 Neo, which has it built in.
So it's like a rumble pack?
Essentially, yeah, kind of. Or so more it, like a 32X or something.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's like an add-on, but actually gives you additional power.
Yeah. And it will give, obviously, more power for the VR, which is what we want. Mm. The Xbox One Scorpio, we'll call it, because that's what they're calling it, will be substantially more powerful than an Xbox One and a PlayStation 4 considerably. The Xbox One operates at a peak target of 1.32 teraflops compared to the 1.84 teraflops of a PlayStation 4. However, documents, PlayStation 4 Neo will be 2.25 times more powerful than the PlayStation 4 and have a peak performance of 4.14 teraflops.
Holy shit.
Now this is where it gets interesting, Dan. The current performance for Microsoft Scorpio is approximately 6 teraflops, which would make it twice the power of PS4 Neo. However,
interesting.
I don't think it is very interesting, Dan. And I'm going to tell you why. This is my theory, anyway.
Go on.
6 teraflops would mean jamming form factor, price range, and heat dissipation energy requirements that will be slightly less powerful than a brand new GTX 1070. And they got to squeeze all that into a console. Right? Speaking of a 1070, a GTX 970 a year ago was about £300 to £400. Right? Mm. Now you can pick one up for about between £200 and £300.
Yeah, so, mine's a 970 GTX.
Yeah. So
is it?
Yeah, you've got the 970.
Yeah, I did, yeah. I think I was after, I was looking at 980 Ti, but I think that was about the same as the 780 Ti, yeah, and the like 780 600, had. It was still, overall, benchmarks, it was better than. So. No, it wasn't 600 quid, the 780 was...
No, the 980.
Yeah, but I mean, that's the one before the Titan, I think.
Yeah. It? Oh, yes, no, you did say 9. Sorry, I was kind of heard what I wanted to hear.
Either way, it's something that was outside of my price range, given. Yeah. But, you know, now we're talking 1080. It's just like, still kind of outside the price range, but fuck me, I wouldn't need anything for 10 years.
Well, no, it's pretty fucking future-proof. But yeah, so a year, 970 a year ago, between 300 and 400. Now, between 200 and 300. Yep. So not much cheaper, really, over the course of a year. So for a technically outdated graphics card, you could pick up an Xbox One. Right? Like the current Xbox One.
Yeah.
So the Scorpio, which is rumoured to be slightly less powerful than a GTX 1070, along, obviously, the GPU, CPU, Blu-ray drive, everything in the console, the case itself, plus a brand new redesigned controller, leads, whatever else is going to be in there. You're expected to get that for less than 400 quid, say. Because look how much people kicked off when the Xbox One came out of how much it was.
Well, they haven't got a Kinect this time with it, so you can't throw on an extra 150 quid for the Kinect.
Yeah, but you've... I mean, the size of a GTX 970, right... is basically most the inside of an Xbox One.
Sure.
And they're going to put a...
No, but it wouldn't be that physical card, though. I mean, there's equivalents for, like, laptops and stuff.
They make the circuit and that smaller, obviously.
Yeah, but you do that and it makes it more expensive.
Yeah. So there's no way this... it's going to be more powerful than an Xbox One.
Yeah.
It has to be. But if they're going to announce it, like the PlayStation 4 Neo still hasn't actually been confirmed. This is all rumour speculation, as is this Scorpio. However, Phil Spencer wants he thinks consoles should be, instead of waiting 8 years, 8 to 10 years for a new console, it should be every 6 months to a year, right? Like they do with smartphones. So people are going to be expected to buy Scorpio, and then 6 months to a year down the line, upgrade it, and then 6 months to a year down the line, upgrade it. That's not going to happen with a console, because you may as well buy a PC.
Only if they make it modular, maybe.
Yeah, but there'll only be so much they can do with such a small... I mean, look at Steam boxes and stuff.
Yeah, they're not exactly built to upgrade.
They're not built to upgrade, and for a decent one, like for a cheap one, it's no better than a PS4 or an Xbox One.
No, but I mean, say if you had something that was divided into quarters, say. So one section was the power, one was the memory, one was the GPU, one was the CPU, something like that.
Yeah.
And one of them had the disk drive in. And if you were just playing everything that you wanted to, you weren't bothered about 4K, you weren't bothered about VR, so you didn't need to upgrade the CPU or the GPU, but the memory... you were going to be playing more games, so you take out that module and you put in a new one, and then it would just extend the memory that you've already got, you know. But if you wanted to upgrade the CPU, GPU, then you could whip those out for 100 quid, trade them in, or whatever, they break them down, parts, second-hand them, you know, and then you could upgrade it piece by piece every couple of years when you could afford to. If they did something like that, I could kind of see the point, but honestly, if you're going to do that, get yourself a fucking PC.
Get a PC.
Yeah, it'll be infinitely better.
But then how... the people that sit there and go, well... I mean, like the... I can't remember who said it now. Somebody, a developer, has said that the PlayStation 4 Neo, all the games that come out will work on the PS4, the standard PS4.
Yeah.
And vice versa. Obviously, they'll look better on the Neo. And I'm going to assume this Scorpio will do exactly the same with Xbox One. However, how long will that actually... will developers sit there and go, well, what's the point in developing two games, two of the same game, one.
Well, no, it'd just be one would be slightly downscaled. It's the same as when you're doing PC and console games. Like the PC one will always be, although it'll look better, it still won't look as good as it could do if it was made exclusively for it.
But yeah, exactly. But developers are going to want to develop specifically for
a console.
Neo and the Scorpio, whatever. Like, it better not be called the Scorpio.
I don't know, Scorpio's a pretty cool name.
I think they should call it the Xbox One too.
Well, no, because Scorpio, that's what Rico's called in Just Cause. So, that, I don't mind that. No.
But then the people who, the early adopters of the PS4 and the Xbox One, how long is it before they get left behind, before the Scorpio and the Neo become the standard PlayStation?
Yeah, I just can't see anyone buying a new console every year.
No, it's just not, seems it's like not a smartphone.
The most hassle. I mean, they've got built-in internal hard drives.
Yeah.
So you've got to keep it if you want to play your old save game? Do you upload it into a server? Do you whip it out? Do they make it, you know, removable and you can put it into your new one? Well, can you get a trade-in value for it? You know, so fair. If you trade it in every year and you only have to pay an extra £50?
It's... I don't think it'll be that something that cheap. But, I mean, like the PlayStation, if you've got PS Plus, all your game saves go on your account. So if you've got a new PlayStation,
yeah, your saves will, but you've still got to re-download all the bullshit again.
Yeah, you still got to put everything back.
If you use 600 gigabytes of space in your actual internal memory, then you buy a new console. Your save games may be there, but in order to play all those games again, you've got to reinstall them all again. That's hours of bloody waiting around.
Depends what you're buying. If you're buying another PS4, you can just swap hard drives around.
Yeah, if it's got, like I say, if it's got a removable hard drive, it's fine. You just plug it in and off you pop.
They're both just like laptop hard drives, but the only problem being, if you open the hard drive cover on an Xbox One, your warranty is void.
Yeah, they're void, yeah.
Whereas PS4, they tell you how to do it and say, yeah, as long as it fits these measurements, slap what the fuck you want in there. Yeah. Which it should be, you know, they do. I don't think... I mean, I think teraflops is the most ridiculously made-up metric term I've ever fucking heard, but...
Oh, I love it.
Yeah, that's what's getting flopped around. That's what's getting thrown around. I don't think Scorpio is going to perform at 6 teraflops. No way.
Well, again, if these are just rumours, these are just speculations. I mean, that could be what the goal is, but then when they start to sort of realise as to what the limitations are, it could very well be they either get to an equal playing field as PlayStation or slightly worse. That's the way it's always been.
Yeah, but then it's... This generation has been all about power, and PS4 is more powerful than the Xbox One. And, I mean, they say maybe the target is 6 teraflops... The target was just 1080p on the Xbox One, and they haven't managed
point,
that.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And, you know, it's going to be a case of, well, they released the PlayStation released the Neo, and it's like, ah, you know, this is pretty good. It looks a little bit better. It's got VR capabilities built in. Also, the Scorpio is meant to have Oculus Rift support as well. Can't see that happening, to be honest.
Well... The fact is, how much better is it going to look?
If you're going to be playing any Oculus Rift games, you need to play on PC, where the actual power is. But...
No, I don't mean necessarily for Oculus. I just mean, in general, you get Uncharted 4 for the PS4, and then you get the PS Neo, and then you get Uncharted 4 remastered Neo version. How much better could it possibly look on that? It's not going from colour to black, you know, black and white to colour, is it? It's going to be... the lighting effects are slightly better.
It's not going PS2 to PS3.
The draw distance
is a massive fucking difference.
A little bit further, you know. I mean, it's not going to be the best thing in the world. It's not going to be life-changing, is it?
No, of course.
Which means that when those games get to that sort of life-changing, holy shit, this looks incredible, then anyone with a PS4 would have to upgrade, because then it wouldn't work.
Yeah, yeah. Which makes a shit ton of sense, kind of. But then...
Yeah, not every year though. Why would you do it every year when people have got to shell out £400 a fucking pop? You get it? That's just bonkers.
So this, for argument's sake, they hit the targets. They've got 6 teraflops on this Xbox Scorpio, whatever the fuck it's called. They hit 6 teraflops. That's not going to be cheap by any means, the console itself. And then they expect you to upgrade it. That's, for whatever reason, that's fine. We'll allow it. And it costs you 600 quid, right? They're saying, the people who have who've done this report, then obviously the Oculus, it's going to have Oculus Rift support, so it's going to be awesome. How much is an Oculus Rift?
Exactly, you add that on top.
So you're talking a grand minimum, if you're lucky, just for the Oculus and this Xbox Scorpio, right?
Yeah.
And then, who plays on the Xbox One? Call of Duty players.
Well, not necessarily. That's a generalisation.
No, that's not... I'm not saying these are the only people that play it, but the people who play Xbox One and PlayStation 4 and to a degree Wii U, stuff like that, don't want to play PC stuff. And
well,
when you start...
Maybe not the... I think it depends. Because, I mean, casual gamers are people who will buy franchise-branded... Not branded. You know, the sort of... Not necessarily new IPs. You know, they won't be taking a risk on, and they go, ooh, Quantum Break. Well, I've only played FIFA, NFL, and NBA for the last 5 years, but this, yeah, I'll pay 45 quid for something that I've no interest or idea about. The odds of it happening are going to be very small. Things like Metal Gear, things like Uncharted, maybe.
Microsoft have done a deal with Oculus, but it's got to be more geared towards the PC because you need an incredibly powerful PC to run Oculus. And
the 1080 comes with Oculus support, doesn't it?
Yeah, the card itself's got it, but you know, you're talking, that's like 600 quid just for the card. So you still got to have a decent PC in order to inhabit the card.
Well, yeah.
And unless Microsoft sell it at an incredible loss, this console's not going to be less than 600 quid.
Yeah, and they haven't made a fucking killing on the Xbox One as it is.
Exactly. And it's...
I mean, I don't know if they've actually made profit from it yet.
I doubt it. They've dropped the price like 4 times already. They said it'd been out a few years. When I got it, it was 350 quid. So that's 100 quid cheaper than when it came out. That was only a year after it came out. PlayStation 4 still, I think it's like 20 quid cheaper or something now.
Yeah.
But they've already made their money back on it, so it makes no fucking odds what they sell it at now. But the way I see it, and again, this is my view, my opinion, I could be totally wrong, but people who play consoles don't want the hassle of playing on a PC, of having to upgrade daily. It's just a case of buy a game, stick it in, play it. Job done.
Yeah, yeah.
And I can't see those people, I mean, again, I could be totally wrong, but I can't see them willingly upgrading every year, even if it's just unplugging one bit and sticking another bit in, when for the last 10 years, they've been able to just play their console, and then it's gone, oh my God, Xbox One, I need to get it. I'll sell my 360 and I'll get an Xbox One, and then they do. And then a lot of them will have the feeling that they've got another 8 to 10 years. And, you know, I'm going to be very disappointed if I've got to upgrade both my Xbox and my PlayStation after only a few years.
Yeah, I mean, if a PC card was released, say if you got a Titan and you'd spent, you know, it's obviously not going to be as good as in this thing that I'm making up. You're not going to spend a grand on it. You're going to spend 300 quid, say, and that's your upgrade. And then a year later, a new card is released that's a fraction better than what you've got. You can still play all the games. You can still play them all. It'll just look slightly better. The draw distance may be a little bit better. The water effects may look a bit shiner. You might get a higher FPS out of it. You wouldn't do it.
No, you'd wait.
Yeah, you'd wait until there's a significant upgrade, like a 1080, something like that comes out. Like people are aware, I've only just upgraded to a 970 GTX or GTX 970, and I'm more than happy with it. It was a noticeable difference from what I had before.
Yeah,
and you know, when there's a 980 or a 780 Ti, I'm going to say, well, I would get, you know, it'd look maybe 20-25% better. You know, the FPS would be slightly higher, so it'd be slightly smoother. You know, but that's not enough for me to go, well, yeah, fuck it, I'll buy it. But the 1080 is going to be such a significant upgrade, and it's going to be so much better than the one I've got. Mm. At that point, with the price that it will be, I will sit there and go, well, that's a really good deal.
Yeah.
You know, quality for price.
Yes, for me, what you get, it is very reasonable. Exactly, considering, at least.
Nothing is going to come out that's going to be an equal amount, sort of an equal scale better than the 1080,
yeah,
in the next sort of 5 or 6 years ago, because there won't be any games that would need something that's powerful.
The breakdown I was, when I said to you earlier, the 1070 and the 1080 had outperformed the Titan X.
Yeah.
The Titan X is like about a grand still. And then 1080 is $600, dollars, so whatever that equals, whatever it will be over here.
About 450 quid.
So I think it's going to be, I mean, a 980 is 600 quid. So I think it's going to be 600 quid, I reckon. And they'll drop the,
well, no, because if it's $1,000 for a Titan and it's $600 for a 1080 or a 1070, then the price difference is still going to be comparable.
Yeah, but I don't think it's going to be, I don't think it'll be a straight conversion.
No, they'd probably round it up, but it'd still be
Same difference. The 980 is $600 and it's 600 quid.
Well, then I'll fucking import it. It'll be cheaper. Yeah. Buy it from an American website, pay bloody postage and packaging, ship it over.
Well, anyway, regardless. They said on the test that they did, like, the 1070 performed really fucking well, and that's only like 300 quid. $349, sorry. But they said it's over, if you haven't got a 4K monitor, it's overkill for a 1080 game, like a 1080p game. It's overkill. You don't need it. If your graphics card plays the list of games that they were doing, you don't need to upgrade yet. That's what they said. But that was just the 1070. They didn't. That wasn't the 1080. But again, that's like £349 just for a 1070. That's the same price as a PlayStation 4.
And it would be what, 3 or 4 times more powerful than it?
I'd probably say so, yeah. That was playing certain games like Bioshock Infinite at 4K at 60 frames a second. So, considerably more so. Obviously, the CPU and stuff adds to that as well. But this is what I mean. People complained because the Xbox One was like 400 and something quid when it was announced, and the PlayStation 4 was the saviour because it was 350 quid. And it's like, this is what the price it should be, and this is for a more powerful console. Microsoft, you suck, blah, blah, blah. And then they go, yeah, we're going to have to drop the price on this quite a lot. Sell at a loss. And then they come out with Scorpio and go, this is how much powerful it is, blah, blah, blah. And then they reveal the price, and it's like, 900 quid. It's like, boo. Because if they come out sprouting 6 teraflops and this flops and donkey cocks and stuff, a lot of the people watching it, especially if they're just watching it at home on their Xbox One, right, the fuck's he on about? It's like, a lot of people don't deal in terms of this. They just go, what can it play? What's it look like?
Yeah, is it better than the one I've got? Yes. Yeah. Can I get Call of Duty? Yes. Sold.
Job done. And again, that's not generalisation or anything. That's just a case of people who care about stats and benchmarks and stuff, game on PC. People who just want to play games, that's myself included, will play on a console. It's a case of, that's why I prefer consoles to PC gaming. I still game on a PC, but I would rather sit on the sofa, slap Uncharted on, or slap Halo on or something, and just play a game.
Yeah.
Because it's easy. And that's mainly because I don't get a lot of time to just play on my own, as I'm just having a kid and work, and obviously the stuff we do together is primarily on PC.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's just nice to just sit and relax, slap a game on.
I still don't get that argument though, because that's what I do. I played for 11 hours straight yesterday. I didn't get bored.
On a game
I didn't
you
get...
already had on the Xbox 360.
Yeah, Xbox 360. There's a difference between buying it on 360, then Xbox One, yeah. then getting it for the PC. There was a significant difference.
Oh, yeah.
Believe me.
I mean, there was a massive difference in when I got the remaster. There was a huge
It's also
difference.
Not on two fucking discs either.
Neither's mine. Neither was the one I had originally on PS3.
Well, exactly. Xbox 360.
Oh, yeah, you had it all on shitty DVD.
Yeah.
What a loser.
Straight to DVD.
But, I mean, that's just how I see it, though. And I, the only way they're going to get people to upgrade every 6 months to a year is if they slap an Apple sticker on it.
No, even that wouldn't work. Like I say, if they offered a buyback system, so you spend 350 quid, 400 quid on your new console, and then as soon as there's a new upgrade, they go, right, we've got the Xbox 1.2. Then you can take that console to a registered Microsoft Xbox dealer, you trade it in for the new one, and it costs you 60 quid.
To get your stuff transferred as well.
Yeah, that's included with the service save.
Yeah.
So all your game saves, all your memory, all that, you can just pop it all into a system, everything's transferred over, and you walk out in 10 minutes, 15 minutes, with a brand new upgraded version of your console.
To be fair, if that's how they did it, and it was like, so it's going to be upgraded every year for 3 years, say. So because it still plays Xbox One games, you've technically got, if you were a day one adopter, say, six to eight years worth of Xbox One, right? Even though you've had these upgrades that you pay like 50 quid a year for.
Yeah.
And then they release an actual brand new Xbox and they say, this one you've got to buy.
Yeah, outright. The upgrade system wasn't working. Yeah. So this one's just a new one.
That I can get on board with because I've been able to keep up to date with all the upgrades for the price of a game and continue to enjoy my Xbox or my PlayStation, whatever it is we're selling. And then 6 to 8 years' time, I can go, I've had a good run with this console. I don't mind buying a new one.
Yeah.
But then...
But the fact is, though, that the differences every year are going to be negligible.
Yeah.
And plus, if there are games, there are teams working on it for 3 or 4 years. So they're making a game for a console that would become obsolete. Because it wouldn't be as powerful as the newest version, which means that you'd need to keep on... You'd be going backwards in time. By the time it came out, it would have looked great on 1.2, but now everyone's on 1.6.
Yeah.
And no one wants to buy it for a 1.6, because there's games for 1.6 that only took 3 months to develop.
Yeah.
And they threw a sticker on it and slapped it in the store.
Well, that's... I mean, like, the...
The way that it works at the moment is fine. When there is a significant enough leap in technology for them to market and construct and sell a console and actually think that they can make a profit from it, but if they can just cut those times down from 10 years to 5 years,
yeah,
then people still get 5 years out of their console before they have to go and buy a new one.
Yeah.
And then they go, holy shit, look at this game, it looks incredible. We couldn't have had this on the previous one.
Yeah.
But if you've got 1.6 and you could have played something that's, it would have been 2% less impressive on a 1.5, then what's the fucking point?
Yeah.
But what's the point?
People would buy it though, because it's...
No, because there's a difference in consumerism between the gaming market and the mobile phone market. Everyone has a mobile phone. Idiots have mobile phones. Not everyone has a gaming console.
That's
and people
true.
Aren't prepared to spend 500 quid on a gaming console every year. Stupid people do that with mobile phones.
Well, this is what annoys me with the report though, is one of the things that fueled the flames, shall we say, is a developer, I can't remember who it is and I can't be bothered to learn that, but they've come out and said, we are developing a VR game for this new Xbox.
Yeah.
That's fine. All right. Sony have got games being made for VR. Oculus are making VR games. HTC Vive's making VR games. That's cool. That's all right. But considering how badly Kinect failed, should Microsoft really be focusing on a gimmick that nobody has adopted, really?
Well, the fact is, though, that there's a difference between VR and there is a difference between that and Kinect. Kinect wasn't needed. It wasn't inspired. It wasn't useful. It had its sort of purpose outside of games, as in terms of Xbox off. You know, Xbox rewind.
Stop turning my Xbox.
That was it, right? That's the only benefit that you had from it, other than if you didn't want to use it for games.
Yeah.
You know, hands, you know, Minority Report, sort of get through your menus and stuff. VR, though, it's a completely engaging thematic experience. And I think that you can't compare VR and Kinect.
No, I'm not not comparing them as the same thing.
What you said that it was a gimmick, and it was something they took a punt on. VR has had too much invested in it from too many different companies to simply just fail.
It hasn't taken off, and it won't take off until...
Well, things aren't available for it yet.
Exactly. So why...
There's a few demo kits and stuff, but other than that...
So why aren't Microsoft holding back and going, fuck it, we'll let PlayStation take... Theirs is already made. It's already been announced. Let's see how well it takes off. And just primarily focus on making a better console, which is what people are buying it for.
That's never going to happen.
That's what needs to happen, though. They need to sit there and go, right, this, because I'll tell you now, hand on heart, VR's not going to take off yet. It won't. Even with the Rift and the HTC and the PlayStation VR, whatever Microsoft use, if they don't use Oculus, it's not going to take off for a while.
No, I mean, this is the thing we've said before, though, is the fact that as a periphery, it's a great idea.
Yeah.
The fact is, it will not be available to everyone, simply due to prices and stuff,
yeah,
for quite a while. When it becomes accepted, and it's not just a fad, and it blows over and everyone forgets about it, when people are desperate for it, when they're excited, then you get other people who make shit versions, cheap versions, and people... Everyone wants one because it, you know, it's a thing for your car. You pop it on in the car, and it's a heads-up display,
yeah,
but also a camera and blah blah blah. You know, as soon as it's accepted as widely as a gaming console or, you know, a fucking mobile phone, whatever, then everyone will have one because everyone will afford one because the technology is so cheap and readily available.
Yeah,
they need to do the groundwork before they get to that point.
Yeah.
So they need to have the preparation, and it's whoever comes on top at this point in time is who will have the sort of the biggest step up in the market, because they already got there. They already developed a bunch of stuff for it. People already think Oculus Rift when they think VR.
Yeah.
They don't think Microsoft. They don't think HTC. They don't think whatever. Because they were the ones who pushed and pushed and pushed and showed what it could do and what they had planned for it. Now everyone, I want a Rift over a PlayStation VR or whatever the fuck Microsoft decided to churn out, or the Mad Cats equivalent of, they would all be inferior because I think Oculus when I think VR. Now, whether that's the best one is debatable.
Apparently, rumour on the street is the HTC is better than the Oculus.
Exactly, but because I know Oculus and I know that they're the people who are pushing for it, they're the ones who want it, they're the ones who got the word out and said, this is the Rift, gaming has changed forever. I think, ooh, I'll look at them. What are they going to be coming out? What's their price scheme? Even though there could be something of comparable or cheaper value that could do the exact same thing, but I still wouldn't be thinking of them because they were the ones who came out first and said, this is what's going on. This is the future.
You know what I think of when I think of Oculus? Facebook.
Why? Just because they own them?
Yeah, they bought it. And we haven't heard nothing since.
So what?
So it was meant to be out by now.
Oh, right. Well, they're probably skint. Starting a Kickstarter page for it. Well, it's the same as it. Yeah, it's not just releasing a patch for Facebook, though. You know, you're talking about hardware development. It takes time. Things can get fucked up.
Yeah, but with the money that Facebook can pour into it, it should have been out fucking before it was actually meant to be out.
I know, yeah, but it's not like Disney and Star Wars. Like, Disney know how to make films. You know, you can sort of pull in resources from everywhere all over the company to help them out. It's not just a case of throwing money at them. But with how many people within the Facebook company do you think can actively design virtual reality hardware?
Didn't they buy not just the peripheral itself, but didn't they just take the staff on who were making
it? Yeah, it would have been... I'm pretty sure it was everything. So they're still working to the same goals.
So
it's just that if now they have a high almighty master to answer to, And if they say, no, no, we need more of this in it, that's what we, you know, we've invested the most, we get to make the decision. So in terms of what they actually set out to do, they may have already done it. But it's outside of their control now as to what can be released. I mean, that's, I'm speculating here, I don't know.
It sounds about right.
If we haven't heard anything specifically from them to say, there's a massive bug with it, we're not happy with it in its current format, and we don't run release it until people will, you know, they'll just ejaculate immediately as soon as they put this on, because they say, you know. And the thing is, though, I've seen a lot of people who have sort of dealt with the Oculus and these sort of VR headsets and stuff, and you see them playing with it, you know, they're tech demos and stuff like that, and they take it off and they're just like, that was amazing, I can't explain how different that was. Because, you know, they'd be like me, they'd be like you, they'd be like most people, they're just used to playing on a TV screen, on a computer monitor. Now all of a sudden, everywhere you look is the game itself.
Yeah.
Like, I can't even begin to sort of process as to how different that would make things.
Well, just looking at the, I mean, I've just got a shitty headset for my Note 4, and just games on that is really good.
Yeah.
And it is very immersive, and I might sound like I'm not a fan of VR, but I am. I'm genuinely very intrigued, and I think it will be something that will change the way we play games and we watch films, and the way they could have augmented reality stuff on there. It'd be amazing. But I think it's
that's if it takes off.
But again,
that's the thing.
Especially when one of the pioneers, shall we say, is going to be Microsoft, who we're not going to give up on Kinect. We've given up on Kinect. Here's HoloLens, but probably not going to release it. But here's HoloLens again. We're still probably not going to release it. We bought Oculus. But they haven't bought Oculus, but they've made some arrangement with them. But again, I'm going to assume that's going to be all PC based. I don't think that's what it's going to be on the Xbox One.
Well, no, like you say, I mean, you still need a very high end PC in order to be able to run it.
Yeah.
I mean, I think with my current setup, I don't think I should have a problem. It's just that
you need to get an Oculus.
Yeah, I need to get an Oculus, which is something at this point I'm not prepared to do.
But on the same kind of principle, though, it's completely nothing to do with Oculus at all. But encouraging people to buy stuff, new things that are new and different. Steam, one of the biggest software whatever's in the world. Is it software? Steam software, isn't it?
Well, the program.
Yeah, the actual thing themselves. But it's like one of the...
Apart from the Steam box, that's...
That's a physical thing, yeah.
That's the hardware, yeah.
But they are, I'd say, one of the biggest companies in the world.
I wouldn't go that far.
In the gaming world, I mean.
Yeah, in the industry, they're probably one of the most recognised. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I doubt that there's many people who don't use a PC exclusively for gaming and don't have Steam.
Yeah.
It's very unlikely.
They'll either have just Steam or Steam and Origin.
Yeah, they'd at least be aware of it.
Yeah, everyone's got fucking Steam. Jesus. A company like that couldn't sell a single fucking Steam controller.
But that's what they're not. They're not known for hardware, though, are they? They're known for fantastic deals on software.
Yeah,
they removed discs from. You know, you didn't need a fucking wardrobe full of games. You just get Steam. You just save it onto the computer.
Yeah.
And it was just cheaper. There's a billion offers on all the time. Indie games, free games, MMOs, all that sort of stuff. You know, that they're actively trying to encourage and help. You know, the new people in the gaming industry start out. Say, yeah, you want to make a shitty game just to sort of test things out? We'll put it on Steam. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Is it racist? No. Brilliant. Then yeah, you can definitely go off.
It is.
So, but I don't. I wouldn't necessarily go to them to say, like, the whole Steam box thing. It's just like, well, it's a nice thing if you can't afford a good PC. It could run the equivalent of that, but for half the price, say. But
it's not, though, is it? They're very expensive, Steam boxes are.
Yeah, that's exactly it. That's kind of the problem.
And I think if they could come out with a Steam box that was the same price as an Xbox One or a PS4, I mean, there are some that are, but not very well spec'd. But they managed to constrain it enough that you can get at least 1080p 60 frames a second. Not 4K, not pushing it too hard, just enough that it's better than owning an Xbox One or a PS4. Then I think they'd fare a much better chance. But the fact is, these are people that make computers, and they've made consoles, and they can't do it for any cheaper than a grand. What the fuck are Microsoft gonna do? They make software. Yeah. They make Windows. And this is why I can't see an Xbox One at the power that these rumours are propelling. It's not going to be cheaper than a fucking grand, unless they sell at a considerable loss.
I was going to say, it would have to be. There's no way that they would ever sell any if it was going to be. Unless, they said, well, you pay 800 quid for it. Now, we know that's a lot, but bear with us. But we've got plans for this. Every 12 months for the next 6 years, we were going to be, we're going to be upgrading. It's technology we're already working on. We're already developing it. We've got this plan, and all you have to do is you pay 800 quid for this, but that 800 quid is for 5 years, and there'll be something that's twice as powerful as it in 5 years' time, and you just bring it back, and we give you another one, provided you haven't broken it or anything. You haven't pissed in it. You bring it back in working order. This time next year, there'll be a 3 week window where you take it in and you swap it out, and we give you the new one for nothing.
That's never gonna happen.
That's the only way that people would say 800 quid. Yeah, let's do it. But if they work out and say, well, if you're buying, it's going to get considerably better every year for the next 5 years, and it would be the equivalent of 2 or 3 console releases, which means that overall it would be cheaper.
Hmm.
But again, it's not just a case of updating the hardware. A new graphics card comes out once every bloody 8 months or something. But the fact is that there's developers and stuff that work with stuff that's out now.
Yeah.
So if you release 10 graphics cards and it's, almost real life, no one's made anything for it.
Yeah.
And it will be years before anyone
can get
would make anything for it, because no one will be able to afford it. So what's the point in making something that looks that good if no one can play it?
Well, that's the thing, though, is that Microsoft don't make graphics cards. They're going to have to rely on actual GPU vendors and creators to go, right, 5 years' time, this is what we need. And then this is after E3. And then they're like, we can't make that. Oh, shit.
Looks like we're going to have to go back on that word again, guys.
But it promises. But the Xbox One reveal, and they were said, we've got the power of the cloud. The cloud is going to make your games going to look better. It's going to make the draw distance literally limitless. And the graphics are going to be better. And this is all going to be done via the cloud and stuff. Name one fucking game that uses the cloud.
I have no idea.
None.
Like, do you know the only thing that Steam could have sold me on?
What, with the Steam box?
No, not necessarily just the Steam box, but Steam, if they said, we want to get more money. We don't just want to get revenue from games and advertising and stuff like that. We want a steady or more stable source of income. If they said there's going to be a subscription service, so all your games and stuff will be the same price. We'll still do all the weekly sales, we'll do all the Christmas sales, we'll do the May the 4th sale, we'll do everything as normal. We'll pay us at £10 a month, say. Maybe 15, 20 quid a month for the service. And what you do is, you buy the game and it's installed on our servers.
So basically,
it doesn't cost you any physical memory space.
GeForce Now, that Nvidia already do.
Yeah, that's the only thing that would... I'd be interested in giving Steam rather than the company that they are selling the game on behalf of. They're basically a storefront. That's kind of what it is.
Yeah, it's just...
But the only thing I'd be interested in buying from them would be saying that you don't have to go out and buy an additional 4 terabytes of memory, because you buy a game from us, we still get the money, but you pay 20 quid a month and you rent...
It's 10 quid a month, just...
Space. No, I went up from that to 20, because there's still going to be a lot of, if you buy 400 games.
Yeah, but GeForce Now is only $7.99 a month.
That's not bad.
And you basically buy the game, and it just plays it from Nvidia servers.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's the thing. I think that's a great idea, because it stops people from spending 50 quid every couple of years to buy a new memory card.
I suppose, but at the same time, if you have a... the internet cuts out, you can't play your games. If your internet's not fast enough, you can't play your games.
Well, that's why £20 would be more reasonable, because it would be able to pick up the people who... it would be able to cover the people who wouldn't be able to use the service. So if everyone had a super fast internet, it would be £8 for everyone. But because not everyone will have access to it or will be able to use it, they have to cover the cost somewhere else.
Fine.
But they're not going to do that, because they've got no need to. Yeah, but then they made a Steam box, and it's just like, well, people aren't necessarily buying these.
They haven't actually made one yet, though, have they?
Well, no, but there's also no... Where's all the TV campaigns? Where's all the advertising all over the internet, telephones, people calling you up saying, have you heard about the Steam box? Like, people don't know who they are.
Well, the Alienware, I think it's the X81 or something like that, that was out a good few years ago, and it was just a console-looking PC that you could slap on your telly, plug in, play. You could do Word and the internet and all the stuff you could do on your PC, but it was designed to look like a console. Right. And obviously Steam Big Picture Mode, you get yourself a little console. That was by Alienware. They've slightly redesigned it a little bit, made it a little bit more powerful, bumped up the price a bit. Made their own actual software for it instead of just having... It's got Windows on it, but it's like a dual boot system. So you can switch to Windows if you want, or use their custom software that's like a console, basically. And called it Steam... Slapped a Steam controller on it and called it a Steam Box. Mm. And then all the other Steam Boxes are all third-party makes, like Lenovo and whatnot, people who make PCs. And they've just made little consoles. Steam, done. Steam themselves, as far as I'm aware, haven't actually released an official Steam box. And that tells you something.
maybe they were just testing the water then. They didn't actually want to invest anything too much into it themselves.
Again,
like
we said though, if it was at a competitive price and it was the power of a reasonably decent PC, not a full-on powerhouse, but a decent PC that was better than an Xbox One or a PlayStation 4 or whatever the console of the time is, but it was cheaper than buying a kick-ass gaming rig, I would be a lot more on board with it. But the fact is, for the price of a decent Steam box, I could buy an even better PC.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and worst of fucking worst, I'll plug it into the TV.
But again, there's no exposure for it outside of people who are aware of what Steam is.
No.
So like I say, the majority of PC gamers will be aware of what Steam is. You know, even the majority of console users, like heavy, not hardcore necessarily, but people who are aware of the gaming industry and they know, you know, they make informed decisions about whatever it is they purchase. But I guarantee you, there's people at work who I work with who play FIFA on an Xbox 360. And, you know, they enjoy that. It keeps them occupied, whatever. I bet you anything, if I went in there and said, have either of you got Steam? They go, what the fuck are you on about?
Well,
they wouldn't have a clue what it is.
You'd be talking to.
But, you know, if there was campaigns all over the place to say, this is Steam, here's an Xbox One, here's a PlayStation 4, here's a Steam box, ours is better, here's an example of that, side by side, here's the price, slightly cheaper, £20 cheaper, and it's better, and all the games, except for exclusives, will work just as well. And you've got the entire PC community to play with, instead of just the Xbox One and PlayStation 4 communities. Yeah. You've got
everyone.
The PC community. Yeah. Then people would go, oh shit, that's actually not a bad deal.
Yeah.
But I haven't seen a single advert for one anywhere.
The only ones I've seen have been on stuff. I'll be on Engadget or something. It's like reviewing the new HP tit-wanking Steam Box. You're like, they're still making Steam Boxes.
Yeah, exactly. It's like Nintendo. It's just like, oh, the Wii's a new thing. This is like, if you don't fucking tell anyone...
That's the biggest mistake they fucking made, was calling it a Wii U. It was fucking ridiculous.
Call it a Wii 2, for God's sake. At least then that sort of gives
new
it away.
Wii.
Well, given the fact that, you know, PlayStation has been very kind of kind, they had the PlayStation 1, a PlayStation 1. Let's just say original PlayStation, a PlayStation, then the PlayStation 1, PlayStation 2, PlayStation 3, PlayStation 4, right? Xbox has had Xbox, Xbox 360, Xbox One. Yeah. No sense.
No. It's...
PlayStation could go for a PlayStation 4.5.
Yeah.
Something that keeps within their number sort of, you know, ongoing titles and say, well, it's not quite a 5 because it's not as advanced as, you know, the leap between 3 and 4, say. But it's also better than the 4. So we'll call it 4.5, 4.3, whatever.
Yeah. They should call it the 4K.
Ooh, that's a good idea.
PS4K.
Yeah, that makes sense, given the fact that that's a perfectly logical name for it. Upscales everything to 4K. Well, I'm pretty sure the PS4 works to 4K now anyway.
Only movies, not games.
Gotcha. But the Xbox One, what do you reckon, if they release this Scorpio, what do you reckon it'll actually be called?
If they hadn't done it already, I'd say the Xbox One Elite. That keeps in line with the 360 and the 360 Elite. And I'm guessing the Xbox One Slim will be called the Xbox One Slim, or S, or something like that. But if you bought the Xbox One with the new Xbox One Elite controller, the console is called the Xbox One Elite. So That's out the fucking window. Because you can't have two Xbox One Elites. One normal and one...
Well, if this is a brand new console, though, then it wouldn't be called an Xbox One because it wouldn't be the same console. It'd be something new.
Yeah, but to keep in the branding...
Well, no, because that's my point. The branding doesn't make any sense. It's Xbox. Xbox 360... Xbox
yeah,
One.
But it's still going to play Xbox One games.
Yeah, but so what? An Xbox One plays 360 games, but it's nothing to do with the title of it.
I suppose. Yeah, but no, that was just added, wasn't it? It didn't originally.
Of course, they were always going to do it. That's how they get people who have massive nostalgia. That's how they get them back on board. What do you think they made for Rare Replay?
I think a lot of people just kept the 360s because they couldn't play them on their Xbox One. And then... after everything Sony did, pissed all over Microsoft, they had one trick left. And like the reason you can't have physical backward compatibility games on PS4 is because it is so different to the PlayStation 3, because the PS3 used the custom-made cell processor unit thing, whatever it was, and it was hard to develop for. And then they went with off-the-shelf PC parts for the PS4, made it a lot easier. But because that cell isn't in there, they can't play PS3 games. And then all Microsoft have done, they've just turned around and gone, ours ain't much different than 360. granted, they do use emulators to play the 360 games, much like the Wii U does with the original Wii games. But at the same time, I say that, though, about the Xbox One Elite. Look at the Wii U. A lot of people thought it was an add-on for the Wii.
Yep.
They didn't realise it was a much better console.
Exactly. It's marketing, it's exposure and advertisement. If you don't tell people what you're doing and how great it is, even if you have to oversell it, then people will never figure out.
I think it'll have Xbox One in the title.
No, I think that would be stupid.
A lot of the things Microsoft do is stupid.
I know, but I mean, would it be...
New Xbox One.
No, because it would have to be something, because there's no link between Xbox, Xbox 360, Xbox One.
Well, the reason they called it Xbox One is because it was meant to be an all-in-one unit.
Yeah, do you know why they called PlayStation, PlayStation 1, PlayStation 2, PlayStation 3, PlayStation 4?
Sequential order?
Yeah, because you know which one's better. Whichever one's the highest number, that's the newest one. That's the latest one.
Yep.
Because if you say there's an Xbox, and then there's an Xbox 360, and now there's an Xbox One, now you confuse people saying the Xbox One. So you mean, what, the first Xbox, or this newest one that's called Xbox
One?
Well,
that's what the people... The one thing people kicked up about of Battlefield 1. It's like, yeah, why is it not Battlefield 5?
Yeah, it's just, for fuck's sake, just keep them in order. How hard is it? Either give them all names, right? You've got the Matrix 1, or the Matrix. Then you've got Reloaded, then you've got Revolution. All different names.
Yeah.
So if you say, have you seen The Matrix? You go, yeah, it's the first film, the old one, it's just called The Matrix. But then it's like the whole Rambo issue. It's like, First Blood... is basically Rambo 1.
Yeah.
And then there was like Rambo First Blood Part 2, which it shouldn't be. It should be First Blood 2, Rambo.
Yeah.
Or something like that. And then it's just like Rambo 3. And it just like,
what?
It doesn't make sense.
Why isn't it First Blood Part 3?
It proper winds me up when you, if you're going to have a sequence to it, if you're going to have a number in the title, stick to the fucking numbers so people know which one's
which. Well,
that's
where Sony went well, though, because it was a PlayStation. It was the Sony PlayStation. And then they released the PS1. And then PS2, PS3, PS4, PS5, I'm going to assume, will be the next one. But like you say with Xbox, it wasn't Xbox One. It was just Xbox. And then it was Xbox 360. And you're like, alright, I'm guessing that's the little, to do with the little ball logo, I'm guessing. I don't know. I still don't know
or
what
like
it means.
Or like the ring 360. That's the thing, there's no real, just two, Xbox 2.
Yeah. And this could have been the Xbox
3. Then you go,
3.
Right, the second one. It, like cars do the same thing that really annoys me. You go, get a Honda Civic. You go, which one?
Yeah.
There's been like 45 different models in the last 30 years, but they haven't changed the name of it.
Well, Apple tried it, didn't they? They went with the iPhone, like it was just Apple iPhone, then it was a 3G, and the 4, then the 4S. And it's annoying, but at least it keeps to a certain order.
Yeah, now we've kind of got the point. So there'll be a 5, then there'll be a 5G, yeah. And then there'll be a 5S, and then there'll be a 6.
Yeah.
Something like
and
that.
And it just goes up. But with the iPad, they called, like, I can't remember what generation it was, but it was called New iPad. And then people were kind of getting confused with it. And then they renamed it iPad Air. And then iPad Air 2 and iPad Air 3, etc. Because it makes sense. If somebody goes in and goes, can I have a new iPad, please? I'm like, yeah, which one have you got? I'm like, I've got this iPad, can I have a new one? Yeah, which one? We've got a couple of new ones. Like, no, the new iPad.
Yeah, like if someone's buying it as a present, and there's like, say if there's an iPad, new iPad, and then an iPad 2.
Yeah.
Then someone goes in and say, can I have the new iPad, please? Meaning the latest one.
Yeah.
And they go, the new iPad? Yeah, absolutely. We've got one right here. That's, you know, 260 quid, please.
That's cheaper than
they
I
take
thought.
It home and just say, this is last year's model.
I've got the new one already. I want the next
yeah,
one.
Yeah, I've already got the new one.
I want the new one.
Yeah, it's like, I don't know if they're doing it on purpose just to fucking sell more iPads or something. Just like, trying to trick people into it.
But, I mean, from what Phil Spencer said, though, that's how he sees consoles going, is a constant upgradable system. And to a degree, yeah, fair enough. But on a much broader scale, no.
No, if you genuinely care that much about it, then I would suggest that you just get a PC, because you're not going to have to upgrade it as often.
It could be cheaper.
And yeah, overall it'll probably work out cheaper.
And you'll get much better graphics and whatnot.
Infinitely, yeah.
And, I mean, again, this is all speculation and rumours. We could get to next month when it's apparently meant to be revealed, E3,
yeah.
I'm guessing. And they come out and go, Xbox Scorpio. And then it's just a box that plugs into the Xbox One and boosts the power. That's all it might be.
Yeah.
We don't know. Or more likely, it'll be a brand new console.
Yeah, we'll just have to see when everything is actually formally announced.
Hmm. Again, this is and a then obviously, more speculation.
Of course, but that's only our opinion of speculation. So, in essence, it counts for shit.
Yeah, I mean, it could be announced and we'll do another podcast work. Oh my god, the Xbox Scorpion is amazing!
Well, that's the fact, though. We've always gone off what can be logically proved as being the most technologically sound, superior, stable, whatever it may be. If the Xbox One was better than a PS4, I'm sure you would have got an Xbox One instead of a PS4.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that. You know, we're not biased against anyone. It's just that if you're an idiot, we'll call you out on it.
Yeah, at the end of the day, I mean, I'm lucky enough to have both, and I can enjoy both, and I can play, if it wants to work, I can play games on my computer as well. But I still prefer the PS4 to the Xbox One. Had the Xbox One had different games, it'd be the other way around, obviously. But I know people that won't buy Uncharted because they'd rather play The Division. And it's like, I can't get my head around stuff like that. If you've got the console, buy the good games.
Buy the exclusive. That's kind of the only reason that you get one.
Yeah.
Like I say, you know, there is a difference between an Xbox One and a PS4, but again, it's not enough to fucking scream about.
Completely honest, I had Ground Zeroes on PS4 and on Xbox One. And for the odd rain and some of the light effects, couldn't tell any difference.
No.
And that's just a genuine... because I remember putting the pictures up on the website for a comparison shot for PC, PS4, Xbox One, 360 and PS3 for Ground Zeroes. And the Xbox One and 360 versions looked identical on the photos. And then I played it, and it's like, this actually looks really good on Xbox One. And I played it on PS4, and I was like, this looks really good on PS4. Wait, no, I'm still playing it on Xbox One. there's not... I mean, don't get me wrong, stuff like Uncharted looks fucking phenomenal. And it genuinely is. I mean, you got to play it last week.
I did, yeah.
And for a console game, it's mind-blowing. The detail on it is really fucking
absolutely
good.
Absolutely. But, I mean, that's the difference between a team that's going to sit down over several years. Yeah. And it doesn't matter what it looks like. It's the sort of the experience in itself. It captivates you.
But it's also a team developing specifically and only for a system. Quantum Break looks really good. Doesn't look as good as Uncharted, don't get me wrong, but the graphics are really good on it. And Tomb Raider. I think Tomb Raider, when it comes out on PS4 at some point, I think it'll still look better on Xbox One, because that's what it was made for.
Well, I don't know, because I mean, the PC version of Rise of the Tomb Raider is still going to look better than the Xbox One version.
Oh no, this is literally comparing the two consoles. It's never going to look as good as the PC version, obviously.
Sure.
But I think it'll look better on Xbox One than it does on PS4. But I don't think it's going to be noticeable better.
No, that's the thing. I mean, like you say, there'll be a couple of effects, maybe a quicker loading time or something like that, but it's not going to be enough to sell one and get another.
No fucking chance.
You know, the only thing that really should come into question is what's coming out for it. What can I get on this that I can't get on the other one? Uncharted. Holy shit, yeah. That should be really good.
I've always preferred, up to yet, at least anyway, I've always preferred the Sony exclusives to the Xbox exclusives. Yeah. And that was one of the... At the time, I could have a PS4 or I could have an Xbox One when they launched. I was like, I'm going to have to go for the PS4 because... I already know, without knowing what's coming out for it, like new IP-wise, I already know there's going to be games that I want already, so I'll get a PS4, so I did. And then this generation might change. I might end up buying more games on Xbox One than I do on PS4, but I haven't as yet.
No.
But is it again, I know people that have got both and they prefer the Xbox One to the PS4. And end of the day, it's preference.
So it's entirely up to you. So don't let anyone tell you one is better than the other.
It's not. Nothing. PC is better than all of them. But I've said it time and time again. If you can afford to, just get everything.
Get both.
Because
yeah, absolutely.
Get yourself a decent PC. Get yourself PS4, Xbox One, a fucking Wii U. Don't get a Vita though. But. to be fair, if you haven't got either or, I'd hold off and wait and see what these new ones are going to be.
Yeah. E3 should be good.
Anyway, we've rambled on long enough, Dan. What's coming up on the channel?
Well, Borderlands has just gone up. That's... So the first part of Borderlands, then Tig Old Biddies, I think it's called. So we're going to do some more Borderlands. There's going to be some more Snowblind, obviously. Yeah. What did I buy? Oh, I got GTA 5 the other day. I think we mentioned that earlier. Sorry, I'm still kind of drained from it.
I still played it.
Yeah, I haven't even been listening. I've just been on the heist this whole time. So I do kind of want to do some GTA stuff, but no fucker that I know has actually got it on the PC. Yeah.
Sorry,
so I can't do anything.
Do you think with the whole Microsoft revealing their new cross-play fantasies, do you think we'll have Xbox One PC GTA? I know they don't own the servers, but if we could have.
It would get a lot of people interested in it. And it would certainly, if people were still weighing up, do I get it on a PS4, do I get it on the Xbox? If they go, well, all my mates, well, like 30% have got it on PC, 70% have got it on Xbox One. But if they do this crossplay, then all of them can play together, then I'll get one of those to, then we can just sort of join in. Then, I'd love to see that, because it would only combine the communities, and then you've got way more people all playing together. And I'd be sort of trying to convince people who have got an Xbox One, go and get GTA. I needed to have someone to do heists
like
with,
me.
For fuck's sake. Yeah, exactly.
I've got an Xbox One.
Oh, have you?
Yeah. I know you should. I know you said PS4 earlier on, but I didn't want to correct you. But,
but yeah, there's so much to do on there, and the fact that it's still popular blows my mind. But, they spent as long developing that as they did the fucking game, for Christ's sake.
Funny that, though. I reckon a good percentage of people who have it on PC play it with an Xbox controller.
Right.
So, there's no... This is literally going back to the crossplay bit. There's no... what's the word? I can't think of the word, Dan. I've gone tired.
I don't know. I don't know what the controller's got to do with anything, though.
No, because of having, like... I was having a conversation when they announced they wanted to do crossplay. I was saying, like, I don't think they'll do first-person shooters because PC players will have a much bigger advantage over console players.
Right, okay, gotcha.
Whereas, because I think, at least, most people play on PC, playing GTA, will play with an Xbox controller. Everyone's on equal ground.
I don't know, because, I mean, the shooting would be more sensitive, it would be more accurate. I choose to use a controller because I prefer driving with a controller rather than a keyboard. And I usually spend more time driving or flying or something.
You don't really need to be accurate, though, do you, in GTA? Compared to something like Call of Duty.
I don't use, like, soft lock or anything, so it's all free aim. So, I don't know. I mean, it depends. Like, if I had an Elite controller, I'm sure it'd be way more sensitive than a 360 controller anyway. So it certainly wouldn't put me in the same league as a PC user by any means, but... I don't know. Get it for the fucking PC.
No, I've got it twice already.
I don't care. I bought it twice now.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure I've paid more for it overall than you have.
I don't know. Oh, you have, because I only paid for it once.
Exactly.
I got the Xbox for free.
Which is why you should buy it for bloody PC and we can do some GTA stuff. So, like I said, I would be tempted to do that, but Rick hasn't got it, Liam hasn't got it, you haven't got it, so at the moment I don't want to be playing heists on my own with a bunch of random people.
Yeah, they're getting death threats.
yeah, exactly.
Anyway, as soon as we finish this podcast, I shall be uploading our Marvel Battlegrounds video that we did at the weekend.
Yeah.
And whenever we get around to it, can you believe it? Because it's still just sat there waiting.
Well, I think you're on the right shifts this week, aren't you?
No, I'm on the wrong shifts this week.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
So it'll have to be next week. Hey, I don't know, see how we get on. But we'll get that done. But the Marvel Battlegrounds video shall be up probably before you've listened to this podcast. And Borderlands is already up. So you can go check that out. Where can they check this stuff out, though?
You can go to the website, which is www.podcastvsplayer.com or .co.uk. You can go to YouTube, which is youtube.com/podcastvsplayer. You can tweet us if you actually prefer to talk to us directly. Somebody did actually leave a comment under one of the Borderlands videos today. So, yeah, so thanks for that.
Forgot your name.
Very quick and also very nice, so... thanks to that chap. But if you want to speak to us more directly, you can tweet us at podcastvsplayer.
No.
Shit. podcastvplayer. Sorry. No S in that one. You can drop us an email to playervpodcast@gmail.com, or you can either do a heart or a comment or whatever the fuck you do on Instagram, which is instagram.com/podcastvsplayer.
You nearly got it perfect, Dan.
Fucking
Have you noticed? Every week I forget to do the social stuff. And I'll be like, say goodbye, Dan. And you're like,
you can
find our stuff. And then you do it perfectly. And then...
yeah, you did that this time.
And then I remembered it this week. And then you got it wrong.
Yeah, never mind, Dan.
Oh, well. Anything before we go?
No, that's been long enough. I need some fucking dinner.
Yeah. Bye.